Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the channel. It's a bit of a mini version of the Celtic the Thunder once more. The podcast was out yesterday, so we're treating them right, aren't we? We're giving them a kind of bonus bit of content, a two-for-one special here.
Yeah, this, you've got to give the people what they want. I mean, we're lucky enough to get invited to talk to players and we need to share it with the fans, know what I mean?
I know. I wish we were able to talk to the board at the moment and talk to Dom McKay, because there's a lot of glaring questions that I would like to just be like, right, come on, what's going on? But we'll take what we're given at the moment. Very appreciative. And it was Carl Starfelt we got to speak to today, Ryan. You were there to ask some questions to him along with other outlets in the fan media. What was that like today, mate? I've obviously watched it back and I've seen all the questions and looked at his answers, but he seemed like a very intelligent guy. He seemed like he was really up for this challenge and ultimately, and of course, I wanted to see him play well, but he started off well on this front because I thought he spoke really well and he's someone who I'm ready to get behind and support right from the get-go.
Yeah, he's it helps that he's really, really fluent in English. Obviously, I had that problem with Abada the last time you had the translator, so you had the sort of the sort of delay between asking your question and then getting an answer. But with Starfelt, it felt pure fluid. He could understand their accents as well, which was great. He spoke really well. He put a couple of the Scottish boys, I would say, to shame with some of his answers as well. He was absolutely brilliant. He was very engaging with his answers. He was polite. I feel like I'm his mom saying that. He was polite.
He was polite. Oh, that's nice. Bonus points on his report card at the end of the season.
You know, he seems like the sort of guy that is going to fit really well into this team. He doesn't look like he's in any trouble whatsoever.
Great personality.
Yeah, definitely. He's infectious. Even the fact that he knows about what songs people want to sing about him. I like that he's noticing things like that.
He's been scrolling through Twitter to see what people are saying.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I was really impressed by him. It was a good first impression he made.
So we're going to talk a bit about the guy himself after we show our clip from the press conference. We'll talk about what he said in relation to how he fits into the system, what we should expect from him, and ultimately just how excited we're seeing him come into this Celtic starting 11. But Ryan, we'll talk about your question before we show it. You wanted to ask basically about how he fits into this system at Celtic with his passing, with his sort of ball-playing ability. So, as I always say, what did you set out to learn today, McGinley?
Well, I mean, you go into these press conferences, you want to be prepared with like five or six different questions because you never know what position...
What order it's going to go in.
You could be the last one and all your questions are done.
I know that pain.
Yeah, it's a complete nightmare. You're scrambling for what you want to say. But I just asked something that I wanted to actually hear about. I mean, you hear the normal mainstream media asking, how happy are you to be here, or what can you do? I much rather want to hear about their exact game, what they can do. I want to bring their sort of past into it as well, what they've done well in the past. Obviously, his passing accuracy was really good in Ruben Kazan, so I wanted to bring that up. And it seemed as if he was quite appreciative of me bringing that up, that I knew my stuff. I don't want to come across looking silly or that. So I think he was quite happy with the question that I posed to him. But I just wanted to... I wanted to learn something that no one else would ask. So I was quite happy with what I got.
Right, well, we'll send you over to the Parallel Universe. Oh, there's a camera doing a funky flash there. We'll send you over to the Parallel Universe version of McGinley speaking to Carl Starfelt this afternoon to hear what he had to say.
Hi, Carl. So you recorded a 91% passing accuracy whilst playing at Ruben Kazan last season, which was the highest in the Russian league. How excited are you to play in a system that will showcase your passing ability as well as your defensive skills?
No, I'm very excited to come here. I think what Ange tried to do, he tries to play a very, very nice football, also very entertaining football, hopefully, that will be nice to watch. And hopefully that we players can get out of attributes on the field in the best possible way. And like you say, to play the ball a lot, to dominate the games, to press high, that's what we aim for. Then of course we have to work very hard to get there. But I think if we do the job every day on the training, then it will eventually come.
Right, so you posed the question about his passing accuracy, that was the answer you got. How pleased were you to hear what he said? Because for me, watching it back, And we'll talk about the rest of the questions and what else he answered here. But the vibes that I got from the opening few questions was this man's got to be great in our system. And I think he's exactly the type of defender we need at the moment with the erraticness. Is that a word, erraticness? With the with the erraticness of the back line we've seen so far. I feel like this is a guy who's got to be able to play out from the back, and he's got to offer us that sort of missing quality we've needed.
Yeah, definitely. He seems quite confident in his own ability, and he's confident in his defensive skills as well, as he's sort of pushing forward with his passing. Yeah, he seems like he's I don't want to be too forward, but he seems as if he's like tailor made and born to play for Celtic. This guy is like tailor. It's everything you could ask for. The sort of Scandinavian centre back that's just going to give you 100% every game. It seems as if it's a system signing as well, which is really good. I don't want us putting in like the wrong jigsaw pieces to this big puzzle that we're making just now. It seems as if this is the perfect fit. We've done our research for this one. And I can't honestly see anything else other than a complete success at Starfelt at Celtic.
Oh, I don't want to put that. You've went bold. That's like me last year with Shane Duffy.
I know, 26 years old, good on the ball, good defender, best passing accuracy, fast. Where is the downside here, honestly?
It's a sort of perfect mould for what we need, isn't it? It's like the perfect storm of the Celtic centre-half. I've seen a lot of people saying...
for Celtic, I'll be honest.
I think a lot of people I've seen already kind of comparing him to Johan Mialbi for that presence at the back. I mean, if we even got half the player that Mialbi was at times, I'd be very happy with that bit of business. The rest of the questions were some really good ones. And as I always say, a shout out to a lot of the guys who are there. You can find a lot of their content all over social media today. 67 Hail Hail, 4 Tims, all the rest of it. You can find different pieces out there. There's no shortage if you want to see the rest of the presser. The first question that he spoke about, and this fits into his kind of style as well, Ryan. They were asking, you know, does he prefer to press high? Does he prefer to sit deep? And he was talking about, well, he can do it both. He doesn't mind. He feels like he can adjust. And it's all about, and he used the word, you know, it's all about adapting. Still football at the end of the day, but it's all about adapting. He said that at some point in the presser. And that was very encouraging, I think. I like the fact that he's not committed to one sole idea, but he's done his research. He knows what he has to do, but he's comfortable with whatever instructions he's given, it seems.
Yeah, and I liked that later on in the press conference he talked about he was actually looking into how Ange's teams play football as well.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
Having that sort of eagerness to actually do some forward planning into your new sort of role or your new job, rather. It's the same for everybody. It's good to have that sort of...
initiative.
Sort of forward, that sort of... I'm trying to think of the word.
Initiative.
Yeah, the initiative to be prepared for your job. It's very welcoming to hear that from a player because you don't hear about that all the time. Sometimes you'll hear about guys and they're just totally lost as to the way we play. And you wouldn't have blamed them if you didn't know, because it's obviously a new manager that's just came in the door. So he's obviously went into Ange's past and that as well, and looked into some of the stuff that he's played. So it all bodes well, definitely. It sounds as if he's definitely interested and he's happy to be here. So
the one thing that stunned me about the whole press conference was when they asked the question towards the end, has he spoke to anybody? Did he speak to Mikael Lustig? Did he speak to anybody? And he said, no, he hasn't. He just knew when the interest was there that this was the right move. He felt it. He wanted to come to Celtic. He didn't need to speak to anyone. Now, I know a lot of people were probably hoping to hear, me and Lustig are best pals. But for me personally, I like that he's went, no, this Celtic's a team. I don't need convincing. That's where I'm going. That's where I want to be.
Yep, definitely. That was one of the first questions I wrote on my wee notes, but it was one of those ones that I didn't really want to ask because it was kind of...
You knew it was going to come up somewhere.
It's good that the only thing he sort of mentioned was Callum McGregor and the fact that Callum McGregor went out and contacted them during his isolation. That's good as well to know that your captain's been so welcoming to a new player who's coming in from a foreign country. I mean, it doesn't matter if he speaks fluent English or not. It's still a new country. He's getting into a new environment, so... It's great that our captain's going out of his way to welcome guys that aren't even physically in the club yet. I know they are now, but when he was in isolation, obviously, it wasn't anywhere near the players. So it all bodes well for the future, I would say.
He did touch on leadership. He spoke a bit about leadership and people were asking, you know, whether or not he needs to bring that leadership to the back line with it being relatively young. But he spoke up and he said, look, it doesn't matter what your age is. I want everybody to be a leader. I want everybody to speak. And I thought that was great as well, Ryan. You know, this is a guy who I think is going to bring a presence and going to bring a leadership to the back line, but he expects it out of the people he's playing with.
Yeah, definitely. I think he's going to help the younger players, especially sort of improve their game, having that sort of rock beside them, which I think this guy's going to be. He's going to be a rock next to Stephen Welsh and Dane Murray whenever they're playing. I don't know what the sort of plan is in terms of getting another centre-half in. We probably won't, to be honest. So those guys are going to need to basically grow up quickly next to this guy, but hopefully this guy can help. It's good that he's mentioning that age isn't really sort of important in that sort of way with the sort of defensive skills and the sort of getting into the first team. It's like I said before, I feel like I'm repeating myself, but it really does bode well that he's going to be this sort of leader next to these guys. It can only help these guys improve because they've obviously had that first team exposure. So now that they've had that and they'll be playing with a guy who's more experienced playing in big games, because obviously Russia's a better league than the one we're in just now, it can only help these guys progress in their careers.
Well, finally, before we move on, before we finish off the video, we play Hearts tomorrow. It will be the first game of the season, as we all know. Will it be the first game for Carl Starfelt, Ryan? Would you put him right into the team? He did touch on the fact he's been obviously in isolation. He's been in a hotel room with really only some weights and a bike. He's probably not in the condition he wants to be, but he thinks he'll get there soon. But would you put him in the team tomorrow? For me, he goes right in.
That was the interesting thing for me as well, what he said, because he said the first day, the first 5 days, it was strict isolation, and then the next five, he moved to a different location. So he has been training over the past 5 days. He has been doing drills or whatnot. I think it's a no-brainer. He has to start.
Don't think we have anything to lose, really, do we? Like, you know, I think if we start Dane Murray, we start Stephen Welsh, you know, there's more chance of a disaster, I would say. I don't think there's much to lose with a guy who still has been training.
He's been in pre-season with Ruben Kazan as well, so it's not as if we're bringing in somebody that's going to be completely raw and still on their holidays. Get a guy that's fitness-orientated, that wants to play for the club, that he's desperate to make his start. I think everything sort of signals to a start tomorrow. I just hope that maybe we can get a certain Japanese player in that team as well, fingers crossed.
Yep. Well, Ryan, that'll do it. Thanks very much for going once again to the press conference. We hope there is more of them soon to bring you here on the channel via the podcast. If you haven't listened to the podcast yet, make sure to go into yesterday's video. Aye, I think I'll do it, Ryan. Thanks very much. And we'll see you all next time.